In different physiographic regions of India, Himalaya is unique. We have already discussed Himalayan region in detail, but there are a number of small questions, short answer questions asked by UPSC or commission related to Himalayas. That's why there are several applied questions related to Himalayas. For example, number one, Eastern Himalayas is environmentally sensitive. If we study the entire Himalayan region, entire Himalayan region can be divided in three main parts: Western Himalayas, Eastern Himalayas, and Central Himalayas. Western Himalayas starts from the river Kali, bordering Nepal and Uttarakhand. To the west of this, it is Western Himalayas. Nepal lies in the Central Himalayas, and the Sikkim and all the eastern states, including Bhutan, is located in Eastern Himalayas. It means the Kanchenjunga, and here to its south, there is a Singalila range, to the east of which it is Eastern Himalayas. Question is, Eastern Himalayas is environmentally very much sensitive. Why Eastern Himalayas, Western Himalayas, Middle, all are sensitive environmentally? What points you will discuss in environmental? You will discuss lithosphere, atmosphere, hydrosphere, biosphere, and especially pedosphere, on which depend the biosphere of that region, which supports life and the people. Thus, we have to focus in this answer how environmental of the Eastern Himalayas is sensitive. So, first we should take lithosphere. We know that here all the three parallel ranges of Greater, Middle and Shivalik turn southwards near Namcha Barwa. This is tectonically very much sensitive, and that's why the lands or rocks are here are of different types, and especially sedimentary and metamorphosed. Here tectonically it is very sensitive because a number of faults and fractures are found here. For example, in the Arunachal Pradesh there are faults, and in here eastern Naga fault, and here in Meghalaya there are Garo fault, Kopili fault, and Dauki faults. Thus, the Eastern Himalaya consists of a number of faults, hence tectonically it is very sensitive. Due to tectonic forces, this is also sensitive seismically, because small or large scale tremors also shake this region. After relief comes the climate of this Eastern Himalayas. Climatically it is again sensitive, because the maximum rainfall in world occurs here in Meghalaya, Cherrapunji and Mausingram. And second point climatically is that the Indian monsoon, especially Bay of Bengal, enters the Assam, and Assam is a type of enclave that obstructs and causes barrier, and the entire Eastern Himalaya receives the orographic rain, which is torrential and causes heavy landslide and soil erosion. After relief and climate comes soil. Pedologically, it is very sensitive, because this consists of mainly sandstone, slate, clay and alluvial soil, which is subject to soil erosion, and here there is a fluvial process very active, which causes large scale soil erosion. And after topography, tectonic and pedology comes biosphere. Biospherically, although the Eastern Himalaya is very rich and diverse, all types of vegetation are found. For example, in Arunachal Pradesh, Greater Himalaya has the coniferous dense forest. To its south, there is mixed vegetation. Along the border of this Assam, there is a deciduous forest having a number of species, population, diversity and density. Thus, this is biospherically very much sensitive. So, the Eastern Himalaya is very much sensitive in all respects, and that's why it is inhabited largely by the tribes, and tribes cut down the trees. There is practice of zooming cultivation, which is disastrous for environment. For example, rock disintegration, soil erosion, and the cutting of trees and the killing of the wildlife. That's why this environmentally very sensitive area has been focused by the central and state governments. That's why a number of biospheric reserves like Namdhapa, like Manas have been developed here, and this way environmentally sensitive, but subject to development by the central and state governments. But question may be asked related to the Western Himalayas. This is also very much sensitive, in which you will discuss first the lithospheric condition, the atmospheric condition, the hydrospheric condition, pedospheric condition and biospheric condition, and human interference. But if there is comparison between the two, the Eastern Himalayas is more sensitive, and at the same time Western Himalayas is also sensitive. That's why independent question may be asked on the Western Himalayas that prove how it is sensitive. The second question is, in West Himalayas the ice line fluctuates more. Here it is applicable in Western Himalayas only, not in the Eastern Himalayas. Why ice line fluctuates in Western Himalayas more, it should be discussed. We have studied that sun shines up to the Karnsar maximum in the north on 21st June, and it is sun that causes shifting of thermal and pressure belts. And when sun is vertical on the Karnsar, the height of ice line and topopause is maximum there. But to the north of this Karnsar, up to the north pole, the height of ice line and tropopause is nearly stationary. It fluctuates maximum here on the Tropic of Karnsar, in the south Tropic of Capricorn, because the convectional current rise along the Tropic of Karnsar maximum. And as we move north, the fluctuation decreases. But here this fluctuation of ice line is more in the Western Himalayas and less in the Eastern Himalayas. Why? In the Eastern Himalayas, which is comparatively closer to the Tropic of Karnsar, the ice line fluctuation should be more, but more is in the Western Himalayas. Why? It should be explained with the help of the proximity of Thar Desert with the Western Himalayas. We know that it is Thar Desert here which is heated during summers May and June, and the convectional current rise here at a very fast rate and up to maximum height. And when the convectional current having heat of this Thar Desert rise up at the height of 1000 km and 3000 km on this Middle Himalayas, on the height of 3000 and 4000 km, the ice comes in contact with the rising warm convectional currents. That's why ice melts at its bottom and ice line rises up more in the Western Himalayas. While during winter season, sun is on the Tropic of Capricorn and the North India is under the grip of cold, that time the Thar Desert also records minus 5 degrees Celsius at Mount Abu, and its temperature comes down to 10 degrees and 15 degrees Celsius. That time the ice line of Greater Himalayas comes down, and sometimes the ice line comes down to 100 and 200 meters. Contrary to it, during summer season when the temperature of this Thar desert is 45 and 48 degrees Celsius, the warm convectional current rise up and cause melting of ice line at bottom. This is the reason that the ice line at Greater Himalayas in the Western Himalayas fluctuates by 200 meters, and this is the reason that in Western Himalayas ice line fluctuates more due to the existence of Thar desert and its heating, its maximum heating in summer and maximum cooling in winter. It is nature of the desert or dry sand that it cools down during winter season and it warms up or heated up during summers. Contrary to it, in eastern Himalayas, ice line does not fluctuate much. Why? Because of two reasons. Number one, eastern Himalaya is located in proximity with the Bay of Bengal, and the impact of water or Bay of Bengal water is on it, and that water regulates the temperature of the adjoining land, and this is the reason that here temperature is on average moderate. The temperature never rises up like Rajasthan, and it never comes down like Rajasthan, because the ocean water keeps the temperature moderate. That water neither allows temperature to rise up nor to come down. The second cause of the less fluctuation in the height of ice line is here dense evergreen forest, and here is sufficient water in the Brahmaputra river valley and floodplain. That why this eastern Himalayan region including Assam is nearly wet and covered with less evergreen and semi-evergreen forests. That's why the height of ice line is regulated or controlled by these two factors. Thus, the question may be answered that in Western Himalayas, height of ice line fluctuates more, but not in the Eastern Himalayas. Because independent question may also be asked that Eastern Himalayas does not record much fluctuation in ice line. At that time, you will explain this and compare with the Western Himalayas. Third point is, in Eastern Himalayas, there are much fog and dew. Eastern Himalayas means the Sikkim and its eastern part of India. And here, the fog and dew conditions are rich in comparison to the Western Himalayas. This can be discussed that this fog and dew are the conditions wherein relative humidity is very high, and due to high relative humidity, fog, a weather condition develops and dew also develops, and these two are found nearly at 95% and more relative humidity. And in the eastern Himalayas, especially eastern India, records very high relative humidity throughout year due to two reasons. Number one, as we have discussed, that the eastern India or eastern Himalayas lies close to the Bay of Bengal, that is a water body which regulates the temperature, provides relative humidity, and temperature is low, relative humidity is much. That's why here fog and dew conditions are there, and maximum fog and dew are found in Assam. Sometimes this type of question is asked, which you will reply with the help of these two factors. Number one, the situation of the eastern Himalayas close to the Bay of Bengal, and number two, it is a densely forested area. Dense forest means greater, middle and Shivalik. All the Himalayas are covered with a number of coniferous, mixed and deciduous forest. And second point, its hydrological condition also provides it rich humidity. because this area receives very heavy rainfall during summer season by Bay of Bengal branch, and which is filled in the low-lying areas or the ponds. And here Brahmaputra is a perennial river, has developed a vast and wide spreading floodplain, and the soil means the pedospheric condition is also here very rich. That's why it provides sufficient relative humidity, which is responsible for the dense fog and dew nearly throughout year in the eastern Himalayas. Thus, the eastern Himalayas has rich humidity and fog and dew because of condition number one, its closeness with Bay of Bengal, its biospheric condition, its pedospheric condition, and its rich hydrospheric condition. Contrary to it, the western Himalayas does not have rich fog and dew because during summer season, when this thar desert is heated, it raises convectional current which up to several kilometer height warms the atmosphere, and with the result, the relative humidity here in the proximity of the Rajasthan is decreased, and it does not allow the dense fog and dew. This is the reason that the eastern Himalayas has much fog and dew, while western Himalayas, due to impact of this Rajasthan hot desert, lacks it. Next point is, cloudburst occurs in the West Himalayas. Its answer is that the West Himalayas, west to this Kali River, means including Uttarakhand, Himachal Pradesh, and Jammu and Kashmir, this West Himalayas has a number of cloudbursts happening, while cloudbursts you will never hear in the eastern Himalayas. What is cloudburst? You will define first. If there is any mountain and the moisture laden wind collide from the two directions, that both the winds which are moisture laden reach up to the top of that mountain, and both the winds having sufficient moisture collide with each other at the top of that mountain. Due to collision, the relative humidity suddenly increased, and that is condensed. The vapor carried by both the winds is condensed, and after saturation level, it precipitates in the form of rainwater. And there is sudden, noise, heavy, torrential rainfall. And this is called cloudburst. It means for cloudburst, one ideal condition is that on a mountain, from two sides, two slopes, wind, moisture-laden wind, should suddenly rise and collide over the top of that mountain. And this type of condition is found only in the western Himalayas, where the summer monsoon Arabian branch comes and collides here with the Shivalik in Jammu and Kashmir and Himachal Pradesh. At the same time, the Bay of Bengal branch of summer monsoon comes in Assam, and forced by this Himalayan range turns west, and moving parallel to this Shivalik in Assam, West Bengal, Bihar and UP moves westward. Although this wind, according to Farrell's law, tries to turn right hand side in North Hemisphere, but these are the Himalayan ranges which don't allow this Bay of Bengal branch to cross them because of their height. That's why this Bay of Bengal branch in this northern plain moves west and comes here at the foothill of Shivalik in Himachal Pradesh, where the Arabian Sea branch is present. Both collide here and rise on the Shivalik and Middle Himalayas from the west side, Arabian branch, from the east side, Bay of Bengal branch, and collision of the two, which have some amount of moisture over the top of mountain occurs, which causes sudden noise burst, and it is called cloud burst, and there is torrential and heavy rainfall that causes the landslide and soil erosion in the western Himalayas, especially in the Himachal Himalayas. And this cloud burst incidence in Himachal Pradesh is called cloud burst, and locally pangola, bomb of water. But during recent days, this trend is changing. Although the answer of this question that cloud burst generally takes in western Himalayas is sufficient, but sometimes in recent days, the cloud burst happening is moving eastward from Himachal Pradesh to Uttarakhand. These days, the eastern part of Uttarakhand, Kumayu, Nainital, Garhwal, are recording a number of cloud burst incidents. Why the cloud burst incidence is moving from the Himachal Pradesh to Uttarakhand? This may be an independent question, wherein you will take the help of this Indira Canal. These days, the Arabian branch of summer monsoon is becoming stronger in relation to the previous years. Why? Because this Arabian branch, when becomes dry after the run of Kutch, this becomes very dry and warm. But here it travels from over Indira Canal, where there is sufficient soil moisture, dense vegetation, agricultural landscape. The wind of Arabian branch, which is dry, flowing from over the Indira Canal belt, receives sufficient amount of moisture, and it gains energy, gains moisture, and then when it collides here, this has more energy. That's why, in spite of colliding here, it travels east, covering some distance and up to sometimes here Kumayu and Nainital region. Contrary to it, the Bay of Bengal branch comes here, causes rain. Sometimes due to El Nino or other factors, it means the Bay of Bengal branch becomes weak and speed slow. That's why, in spite of reaching here in Himachal Pradesh within time, its speed is slow. That's why it reaches up to here the foothill of River Kali, and within that time, this Arabian Sea branch becoming stronger, having more moisture, comes up to this point, and both the branches, means Arabian Sea branch and Bay of Bengal branch, collide at the Shivalik of the Garhkum Himalay or the Uttarakhand Himalay. That's why cloud burst, in spite of in Himachal Pradesh, takes place here in the Uttarakhand region. This may be discussed why the cloud burst incidents are marching from the west or Himachal Himalay east to the Uttarakhand Himalay. Next point is, in west Himalayas, there is no Bhabhar and Tarai. You will define what is West Himalayas, what is Central Himalayas, and what is Middle Himalayas. Then you will discuss what is Bhabhar and Tarai. Bhabhar is virtually the low-lying deposit of boulders, and at the foothill of the Shivalik, there are deposition of boulders. Boulders of different size, large, small size, and these are brought down by the different rivers, which are snow fed, rain fed, and bring down the eroded boulders by their force due to steep slope. Those boulders cannot be carried down south the Shivalik foothill because of gentle slope, alluvial deposit, and the Gangetic plain. That's why those boulders are deposited at the foothill of the Shivalik, and those boulders are deposited in different shapes For example, some are alluvial fine. These are called alluvial fine because deposition of boulder is fine shaped, like in delta. Sometimes they are deposited in the form of core. That time those deposits are called alluvial cone. These collectively alluvial fine and cone are called dry delta because these have delta shape but not delta like deposition, because here boulders are deposited. Now come to the question that in the Western Himalayas this deposition of boulder is less, more in the Eastern Himalayas. In the West Himalayas, why these are less? Because if you tectonically see that here it is Aravalli region, and along this Aravalli region the land has been uplifted or elevated, due to which there in the plain and in the mountain there is less difference or vertical difference. And here you might have studied in the physiographic division that the 350 meter contour line separates the Himachal region and this Punjab plain. It means the height of contour here is much. Contrary to it, here in the east, 150 meter contour line separates the middle and lower plain from the Shivalik or Himalayan region. It means the slope in the eastern and central Himalayas is much, and less slope in the western Himalayas and Punjab plain. If you want to travel from Punjab to Himachal Pradesh, their slope is less. Contrary to it, if in central and eastern Himalayas, if you stand at the foothill of Shivalik and see very lofty mountain, there is very high slope, vertical slope. That's why rivers erode down the amount of sediment and boulders of large and small scale and deposit that along the eastern mountain Shivalik foothill, and less deposition in the western Himalayas. These depositions start from this Haridwar, and here these are called dwars, while in the eastern Himalayas means at the foothill of Shivalik, here in Jalpaiguri in West Bengal, it is called Duar, D-U-A-R, and the interior part is called Ghar, G-H-A-R. Thus, the boulder deposition starts generally from Haridwar and up to the eastern Himalayas, and less boulders are found here in the foothill of Shivalik in Himachal Pradesh, like Satluj has less deposition of boulder at foothill. Thus, this question may be answered in this way, that due to tectonic, the western Himalayas at the foothill has less slope, the eastern Himalayas at the Shivalik foothill has steep slope. Hence, the much boulder deposition in the eastern Himalayas, less in the western.